Good morning. Well, good morning, Life Community Church. Why don't we stand and worship God this morning?
Come on, you can clap enough. Here we go.
Worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. Our God, He holds the victory. Yeah. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. Shout out. Surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Sing that again.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. Shout out your praise. Oh, shout out.
Good morning. It's so great to be here, have you here. My name is Kelly Wenzel. I'm one of the worship leaders here at Life Community Church. It's Palm Sunday, and we are so happy that you're all here. We want to extend a warm welcome to those that are first new time people. And if you could, there are some cards in front of you that you, if you want to fill out, we'd love to know more about you. And right now, we're going to take a moment in the time of the service, turn your attention here, and we're going to show what God's been working on people, on their lives, in this community and at home.
Hi, Life Community Church. I'm Brandon Hall. I get the joy of serving as the lead pastor here, and we are so glad you're worshiping with us, our Lord and Savior. It's an amazing day, Palm Sunday. I'm actually not here. I'm with my family at Zion, hiking around, camping, enjoying some time with family, and it's a great time to get away, and I'm so excited as Jeff brings the word on the approachable God and just this idea that God, who is the creator, sustainer, savior, is approachable and makes himself known that way and revealed that way. Man, it's an amazing week as we pause and look at who God is, what he's done, and even with our mission statement, that first thing to experience new life in Christ by knowing God. Knowing God is salvation. Whoever finds him finds life. And we proclaim that and declare that through our changed lives. But as we pause, we want to take the next 8 days from Sunday to Sunday and look at what Jesus declares himself to be by name. See, in Exodus, when God reveals himself to Moses in the burning bush, and this crazy experience, the bush isn't consumed, but it's on fire, and Moses is trying to get his bearings and try and understand who this God is that's telling him to do stuff. And he says, okay, I'm going to go to the Jews. I'm going to tell them God sent me, but what's your name? And God says, tell them I am sent you. Clears everything up, doesn't it? And as we look at this, the most profound I am statement in John 8, where he's in the temple with the Jews, with his people, where Moses went back to. Here we go, fast forward, about 2,000 years later. Abraham's already dead, and Jesus declares, before Abraham was, I am. And he says the same name, by his name. I'm God, I'm the creator, sustainer, savior, fully God, fully man, before Abraham, I am. Super clear, right? But that's why he's God and we're not. It challenges our mind. How could the God who created everything and sustains everything and is the savior of all people and all names never have existed, but always existed and always will exist and is unchangeable today, but everything he touches does. And so as we sit with the weight of I am, knowing his name, knowing the power and the purpose of the God who had a plan to save us and sending his son. We're going to talk more about that today, but in the coming days, we don't want you to miss what God's going to reveal to you about his character, about his nature, and about him drawing near to you, giving you the boldness to proclaim his name, that by his name and his name alone, we have salvation. And so as we think about the I am statements that Jesus makes over the coming days, you can get on the app or our Instagram. It's awesome. We're going to have questions for families and any believer to really dialogue and dig deeper as we pause on the power and the purpose of his name as we go and proclaim that there is salvation found in no other name but Jesus alone.
Amen. Will you stand and will you greet each other in the name of the Lord Jesus and say, God is the great I am. Let's worship the Lord.
I was buried beneath my shame. I could carry that kind of a weight. It was my tomb. Till I met you, I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried it was my tomb. Till I met you. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. Now you might have seen how you saved my soul. Sin was heavy, my chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open.
I believe in the You're never gonna let me down.
When the night is holding on to me, God is holding on. When the night is holding on to me, God is holding on.
Lord Jesus, you are holding on to us today through our worship. And Lord, in the darkness, in the fear, in the shame, in the doubting, in the anxiety, Lord, in all the things that our human nature, our fallen nature brings, you are there for us, Lord Jesus. You are in our hearts. You're in our minds. You are the God of the universe. You are the God of our hearts. And we worship you and praise you and are so grateful for all the things that you've done in our lives. And with that, we all say amen. And you may be seated. Right now, if you could turn your attention to the screen, here's what's going on in the life of Community Church this week.
Good morning. I'm Andy Malone, office manager here at Life Community Church, where our mission is for people to experience new life in Christ by helping them know God, grow in relationship with God and others, and go and make disciples. If you're one of those who've been faithfully giving to make this mission possible, we want to say thank you. If you'd like to give, there are three ways to do so. We have black boxes at the back of the sanctuary. You can give online or on our LCC mobile app. Coming up over spring break, our youth group will be spending 3 days serving our community. We're inviting families and life groups to serve alongside of them for 1 day, April 6th. If you would like to join the youth and serve the community, you can go and sign up on the LCC mobile app. And then next Saturday, April 13th at 4:30, we'll be hosting a marriage night here. So couples who are married or looking to get married, join us for a delicious tri-tip dinner and a talk about fighting. Every couple fights, but let's learn how to fight for our marriage and not against each other. You can sign up on the LCC mobile app. Tickets are $45 a couple. And finally, Easter is coming up this weekend. We will have our Good Friday worship night at 7 p.m. and we'll have our Easter services at 8:30 and 10:30 a.m. with baptisms at both services. If you could go on the LCC mobile app and let us know which service you plan to attend, that would help us to prepare. And if you're a believer who has not yet been baptized but would like to be, you can go to the Connect booth and get a baptism packet. There's still time to sign up for that. And finally, don't forget to invite your friends. I mean, what's the worst that could happen?
Just ask him. What's the worst that could happen?
Hey, Jeff. I was wondering if you'd like to go to church with us sometime. I just thought. Okay. Hey, Jeff.
Oh, hey, man, what's going on?
Hey, I was wondering if you'd like to join us for church on Sunday.
Yeah, I don't see why not.
Cool, man.
And now, we invite you to continue worshiping with us through the reading of God's Word.
Well, good morning. I encourage you to grab a Bible. Grab your app, grab it if you have it close by. We are going to be in the book of John, chapter 12 this morning. But if we haven't had a chance to meet, my name's Chris. I get the opportunity to serve here at Life Community Church in a couple different ways. First, I get to serve in children's ministry on the worship and teaching team once a month, which is a great time. And then I also get the opportunity to serve as one of the elders here at the church. And so we're going to the book of John to prepare for obviously next Sunday with Easter Sunday. So I'd encourage you to join me. We're going to be in verse 9 going through verse 26. So John chapter 12, verse 9 through 26. When the large crowd of Jews learned that Jesus was there, they came not only on account of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he'd raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well, because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. The next day, the large crowd that had come to the feast heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, so they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, crying out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." And Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, they remembered that these things had been written about him and had been done to him. The crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to bear witness. The reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they heard he had done this sign. So the Pharisees said to one another, "You see that you are gaining nothing. Look, the world has gone after him." Now among those who went up to worship at the feast were some Greeks. So these came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and asked him, "Sir, we wish we could see Jesus." Philip went away and told Andrew. Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. And Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it. And whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him." This is the word of the Lord.
Well, praise be to God. Thanks, Chris. My name is Jeff Bauer, and I get the privilege to serve as the worship and groups pastor here at Life Community Church. And it is truly a joy, as it always is, to share God's word with you. Just a note, I may say some things that encourage you. They might be memorable. They might inspire you. They might even make you laugh at the same time. But none of my words will change you. Only God's word will change you. And I love, Michelle and I love being at a church that celebrates and honors God's word. It is the pinnacle, if you haven't noticed, the very centerpiece of our service, where we proclaim the word as it is written. And that's what changes us. It's his word. One of the many things that Michelle and I love about this church also is just the blessing to serve a pastor who faithfully stewards the word of God here in the pulpit. And also out of the pulpit in his own life and in the life of his family. And so that creates a place that is both safe spiritually and emotionally for us, for our family. And so we're grateful to serve here, and it is an honor to be with you today. I'm going to start with a quick story from my eighth grade year. That was not a good year. It may have been a good year for you, not a good year for me. Middle school was traumatic, and I didn't fit in. My ears were too big. My voice was too loud. I had freckles. I had no friends. I spent all of lunch period of my eighth grade year reading Isaac Asimov books in the library. Nobody in here knows Isaac Asimov. That's funny. Okay. Because you would have laughed at an eighth grader reading those books in a library had you had the joy of reading them. But I did have a really funny English teacher, and his son, my English teacher's son, is actually now still a good friend of mine and cuts my son's and my hair every 6 weeks. But back then, Dave's dad was my English teacher, and he gave us an assignment. And he said, asked the class to write to their favorite celebrity. And so most of the kids in the class wrote to actors or athletes, and they asked for these signed photographs. That was the thing back then. You know, you could took out a pen and actually signed a photo. And so I took the opportunity to write to Vin Scully. Now, Vin Scully was the longtime announcer for the Los Angeles Dodgers. And just in case you were wondering, if you're a Giants fan, the Baptist Church is up the road in Paso. You are clearly south of the Spring Street line, and you are in Dodgers country here. Vin is the reason I love baseball. Growing up, I snuck my Sony Walkman. For those young people in the room, that is a device you put batteries in, and you could actually listen to analog radio stations and play a cassette tape for things that you taped off the radio. But I would sneak my Sony Walkman into my bed to listen to the rest of the game because my bedtime was 9 o'clock and most of the games didn't get over till after 10. And from his commentary on the game, I learned to love the game, but I also learned to love the people in the game, both the players and the coaches, and just marveled at that. So I wrote to thank him for inspiring me and doing such a great job. Well, most of the kids in the class, they never heard back from the celebrity they wrote to. A few kids actually did get back signed photos, but I got a handwritten note. It's on a little half sheet of paper. Unfortunately, I lost it. So, but I got a handwritten note, and it said, "Dear Jeff, thank you for the kind letter. It is a privilege to do what you love for the people you love. Best, Vin." That was different. I remember I sat at my desk, and I just stared in awe at the note. Like, he actually wrote back to me. Later in high school, fast forward a few years, I had an English teacher, another one, whose husband actually happened to be the production manager at Dodger Stadium in charge of the media team that was responsible for everything that was displayed on the giant Diamond Vision screen over the left field pavilion. And knowing what a big Dodger fan I was, she got me a pass to watch a game from the production booth with her husband and all the tech people. Well, while I was there, the guy figured out I was a pretty big Vin Scully fan, and he said, "Would you like to meet him?" So I jumped at the chance. We rocked around a few hallways to the radio broadcasting booth. And I would say, Vin was the most welcoming human being. I mean, this was maybe an hour before game time. And he just got up. He said hi to that guy. He asked me a few questions. He put me at ease. Never once seemed to be in a hurry or an upset at the interruption. The whole interaction maybe lasted 3 or 4 minutes, and then we left. But again, it was different. Fast forward 20 years, I had the chance to take Aaron, my son, to a baseball game, a Dodger game on his 8th birthday. That was September 25th, 2016. And this happened to be the final game that Vin Scully called at Dodger Stadium. And after the game, Vin and his wife Sandy got up in the radio broadcasting booth and they had "You Are the Wind Beneath My Wings" played through the stadium while they sang it to all of the fans and the coaches and the players and the stadium staff. And it was a surprisingly intimate moment that we shared with 56,000 people. Because all those people had one thing in common: Vin was part of their family. Most of them probably had never met him, but there was not a dry eye in the stadium, and that was different. One of Vin's most beloved qualities was this unusual approachability. There are a few people, probably few people that ever attain his level of fame or fortune and also maintain such a sincere connection with their followers or their fans or their community. And so it may be no surprise to you that Vin was a devoted Christian, a Christ follower, because Jesus himself displays an unusual approachability, which we see in this passage and in many others in the Gospels. Jesus was different. His approachability surprised his own disciples regularly. They were surprised at who he had dinner with, who he invited to share space with him, who he let interrupt dinners he was already at. Surprised his disciples. His approachability confounded the Pharisees, frustrated them, made them angry, tied them up in knots. And his approachability changed the world for people that he met all over Galilee and the areas that surrounded where he did his ministry. Now, to be approachable is to be welcoming. It's to be accessible. It's to be open, hospitable, friendly, sincere, available. Now, here's a question. So according to the expectations of the world or our culture, the higher the status a person is, what would you expect to happen to their approachability? Would it go up or down? Down, yes. So yes, the higher up in the ivory tower you go, the less approachable you become. But see, this did not hold true for Jesus at all. And it should not hold true for us, his people, his followers. How approachable are you? How approachable would people say you are? Do people leave interactions with you and say, that's different? So let's look at Jesus in this passage as one, the approachable star, the approachable king, and the approachable savior. Stars stand out. If you look up in the night sky, stars stand out against the backdrop. You can clearly see them, and that's how we get the illustration why we call people stars, because they stand out. They're different. They have amazing abilities. And, you know, Vince Scully from My Story, he was famous because he was the greatest sports announcer of all time. And he did it well for almost 70 years. He had an amazing ability. Well, Jesus also had amazing abilities. He taught like no one else. Scripture says that people marveled at his words or at his teachings. That's Matthew 7:28. He healed people of all kinds of sicknesses. I mean, people that were in unrelenting pain. They were dying from debilitating conditions. They were social outcasts because of sores on their skin, right? They have an encounter with Jesus, and suddenly they're well and able to go on living a life, a different life, a new life, a normal life. He cast demons out of people. Those people who were insane or bound, possessed, mentally unstable, were returned to their right minds. He even raised Lazarus, a regular guy who had died, raised him from the dead. Jesus stands out. He's a star against the backdrop. Revelation 22:16, Jesus actually identifies himself as the bright morning. Come on, folks. The bright morning star. Yes, he is the approachable star. Crowds followed him. Crowds of Jews had come to Jerusalem for the Passover festival, but see, there were also Greeks that had come to Jerusalem. Greeks didn't celebrate Passover. They were Gentiles. They didn't grow up celebrating that holiday. They weren't in Jerusalem to celebrate that holiday. They were in Jerusalem because they heard a guy who was dead wasn't dead anymore. And they wanted to meet this guy who was dead who wasn't dead anymore. And they wanted to meet the guy who raised the guy who was dead but wasn't dead anymore back to life. So the Greeks, verse 20 to 23, shows us that some of these Greeks, they wanted to meet Jesus. They wanted to see him, maybe like I wanted to meet Vin. I don't know. But they wanted to go, they wanted to meet Jesus. And you can almost get a sense of what happened in this little interchange. Now, I'm going to add some dialogue that could have happened. That when you see the progression of Scripture, you know, the Greeks went to Philip, Philip goes to Andrew, Andrew goes to Jesus, Philip and Andrew both go to Jesus, and then Jesus gives this response. I'm going to give some dialogue that may help, I think, be a possible reason for that progression. So Philip was from Bethsaida. He grew up in Galilee. Galilee was a kind of a more metropolitan city. It had both Jew and Gentile living side by side. So these Greeks who come to Jerusalem, they may have recognized Philip or knew he was from Galilee. They knew he was probably accessible or approachable. So they go to Philip and say, hey, we'd like to meet Jesus. And Philip is thinking, this is Passover, probably not a good time. I'm going to get a second opinion. So he goes to Andrew. Andrew's a Jew and a fisherman. Says, hey, these people want to meet Jesus. What do you think? They both look at each other. I don't know. Don't really want to overrule Jesus. Not sure what he's going to say. Probably not a good time. So they both go to Jesus and they bring the matter to Jesus. And you can tell by Jesus' response that it was a partial rebuke for how they brought the matter to him. I'll read, Jesus answered them. He said, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it. Whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Here's the key then. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there will my servant be also. I lost my place. Isn't that awesome? Yes. If anyone serves me, he must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Jesus basically tells his disciples, he says, you're missing the point. I am here for anyone who wants to follow me. And following me isn't done from a distance. As you boys know, Greek or not, bring them in. Right? He says, where I am, there will be those who want to follow me. They're going to be with me. He was saying, hey, it's not about the festival. It's not about the festivities. It's not about whether this is the right time or not. They're here. They're seeking me with a sincere heart. Bring them. Let them in. Other examples, Jesus welcomed the Canaanite woman in Matthew 15, 23. Canaanite women, that would have been a Gentile. Him and his disciples were having a meal together. She was interrupting their dinner. She was a nuisance. She wasn't Jewish. And Jesus says, no, you know, just bring her in. And they have an encounter there. Jesus welcomed all the kids and the disciples that the disciples tried to send away for being a nuisance. Jesus said in Matthew 19:14, he said, let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for such belongs the kingdom of heaven. Kids in those days, you didn't speak unless you were spoken to. You wouldn't be in a situation where there was a rabbi or a teacher explaining or talking or giving a lesson or giving a talk or whatever that was. Kids would have either stayed home, been on the outskirts. You're not part of that. And he says, no, bring them to me, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And that's one of the things, that one of the reasons that Jesus regularly dismantled this gatekeeper mentality and welcomed all kinds of people, anyone sincerely seeking him out with this holy approachability. He had dinner with people he wasn't supposed to. He welcomed people to talk with him that were in the wrong place or had the wrong pedigree or were tax collectors or were sinners or fishermen or women or Gentile or Samaritan or whatever it was. He had a holy approachability for anyone sincerely seeking him out. And that's, you know, as a side note, that's one of the reasons why here at Life, where we lean in to family ministry, to children's ministry, to youth ministry, because theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Yes, it might be louder, but it's not so that we can be cool or trendy or have the loudest music or the brightest lights or the hippest church or anything like that. It's because Jesus said theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We're handing something off. We're bringing the gospel to those who are seeking Jesus out. Friends, we already have him. We're sharing him with those that are coming up. And so Jesus is that approachable star. Jesus is also the approachable king. See, kings are known for their power and authority. And in this passage, we see a stark contrast between the Pharisees and Jesus. You see, the Pharisees desired the power and the authority of kings. With blinding pride, they believed they deserved this influence, this place of prestige and honor over God's people because they had earned it with the right pedigree, because they were son of this person, son of that person, son of this other person, and they had the right training. They'd memorized all the right things. They'd gone through all the right ceremonies, and because they had fastidiously kept every detail of the law, they believed They deserved it. Yet, when they were faced with Jesus, who had true power and divine authority, they just couldn't see it. That's what a religious spirit does. I'm not talking about undefiled religion in that sense that Jesus said is to care for widows and orphans, but a religious spirit that says I can earn my place in God by the things that I have done, and anyone who doesn't have the same checklist as me is probably not as good. Even if we don't tell ourselves that consciously, that religious spirit will blind us to see Christ as he really is. So instead, the Pharisees, right, were envious, they were fearful, and they schemed against Jesus. Even to a point where in this passage we see that they were willing, they wanted to kill a man who had been raised from the dead. Right? Lazarus was dead, he was brought back to life, and they were willing to murder him, kill him again, just to discredit Jesus. See, religious spirits will... You'll justify all kinds of crazy things. Think about that for a minute. And then there was Jesus, all powerful, total authority, but no pride, no worldly stuff at all. This procession that he was a part of, you know, this crowd had gathered not only to see him, but to talk with Lazarus, who had been raised from the dead. It's called the triumphal entry, like when Jesus comes into Jerusalem to celebrate this Passover. And it's a spectacle in that sense because it mirrored the type of procession that would also often be granted to foreign kings. So a king from one city or one region would visit a city in another place, and the king of the town that was getting visited would send out peasants or would send out people from that city to line the road leading into their city. That's where the idea of like roll out the red carpet came from, because they would roll out these runners that would go for, you know, sometimes miles outside of the city that the king would walk in as a show of honor. You know, they would give their peasants coins and money to throw at the feet. And so you can see like they had formed this similar kind of procession. But instead of a procession of servants carrying a king on a high portable throne above the sight line of the crowd, here was Jesus riding on a lowly donkey, a beast of burden, right at eye level with everyone. That was different. The crowds were not supplied with coins to throw at his feet or a red carpet to extend. That was different. Instead, they threw their own clothes on the road. Now, these people were probably not going home to a closet they could fill with three trash bags to take to Goodwill of clothes that don't fit anymore or are not in style or maybe have a hole in the elbow or something. I mean, these are people that may have had the clothes they had on plus one or two other outfits. And they were throwing their clothes at the feet of Jesus. They were laying down palm leaves or palm fronds. That's why it's called Palm Sunday, because the palm fronds were going on the ground since there was no runner or carpet to lay down. And they sang songs. See, this crowd used whatever they had, and that was enough. All of the importance and the sincerity of true worship was there in that crowd, without any of man's meaningless luxuries. You see, anyone could be a part of that procession, no matter their social standing. And so we see in Christ's triumphal entry what matters to God, not man. Jesus the King is approachable. The King with all authority and all power humbled himself, did not count equality with God something to be grasped, but he humbled himself to take on flesh, to even ride into Jerusalem on a donkey, submitting to the will of his Father, because he was approachable. But do not confuse Jesus' approachability with informality. See, Christ is not informal. He is approachable, but he's not informal. See, informality is casual, everyday, common, sloppy, unofficial. And our culture, probably especially in California, is plagued by informality. We lack reverence in matters that require honor. We're loose with our speech. We're loose with our jokes. myself sometimes included. We lack sincerity and reverence and things that would require ceremony or preparation. Sometimes we even celebrate informality in the church. But make no mistake, God is not common. He is, though, approachable. So God is our, Jesus is our approachable star. He is our approachable King, and he also is the approachable Savior. See, some people might be referred to as a Savior because they saved the game with a great play, or they saved a sale with a great meeting, or they saved a war with a great display of tactical prowess, or they saved a movement, or they saved a people, or they saved different things. And, maybe names like Nelson Mandela or Martin Luther King or Mother Teresa might come to mind. But see, Jesus is not a little s Savior. Jesus is the big S, the capital S Savior of the world. And in this passage, he gives us a startling look into what saving us would require. See, saving us would not just require him to serve the ones who would forsake him, like the disciples all in the craziness when the pressure started going down, as they started to realize what was going to happen and what was going to happen. You know, they forsook Jesus. They denied him. They scattered. They ended up in places where they shouldn't be, right? It didn't just require him to serve those who would betray him. It didn't just require him to serve the one who would betray him. So Jesus comes into Jerusalem, he celebrates the Passover with his friends, and he gets into the lowliest position a person can have, and he washes his disciples' feet. Even he washes the feet of Judas Iscariot, who had betrayed him for 30 pieces of silver and ruined that name for, you know, all the rest of humanity. I mean, nobody names their son Judas anymore. But he washes his Judas feet without resentment or bitterness. Who does that? That's different. That's not like you and me. We are not there yet. That may be what Jesus in us wants to do, would do, but that is not our default. That is not the place where you and I find ourselves on a regular basis, washing the feet of those who are betraying us. We're not there. But Jesus is. Saving us would require sacrificing himself unto brutal death for us without resentment or malice. You see, the crowds of people, they were worshiping him freely and truly and sincerely, and you can see that in the text. But there's something ironic about that procession. Because, see, they were saying, "Welcome, all hail King Jesus, King of Israel, Hosanna." They think they're welcoming Jesus in to have a regime change. Out with the Roman governors, in with King Jesus. They think that their Savior, or the one who's going to change their current circumstances and the balance of political and social power is going to change. They think they're welcoming in for that kind of change. But what are they welcoming him in to do? They're welcoming him in to die. I mean, that the irony of the King of all kings being welcomed in, people worshiping him sincerely, but they don't still quite get it. What's going on? See, we've spent so much time, we're thinking that we're approaching God, like we can get close to him, even though he has these amazing abilities. He can heal people. He can raise people from the dead. He teaches like no one else. We want to be near him. We want to be near him because he has all authority and all power. We think we're approaching him when really he's approaching us. And he's not just approaching us to pick the next president. He's approaching us to die for us. Verse 23 and 24 says, Jesus said, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. There is so much in this short little illustration. Jesus is that grain of wheat that fell from heaven to the earth to die in the dirt and the dust. But in his death, friends, we're all in the fields of those who are lifting our hands and our flowers, our fruit, all that is in us. We are the grain, the stalks of wheat in fields of 1,000 hills, praising his name in freedom. We are the fruit that he has borne because we are born again, because he fell to the earth and was planted and died. He says he did not want to remain alone. Right, says, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. Now, Jesus, God the Son, was not alone in the sense that God is always God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit. They are entirely sufficient, communal, and one within himself. But what he meant is that he didn't want to be alone apart from us, his beloved. And so he came to die in the dirt, to bring us forward, that we would be born again and reunited with him forever. You see, our approaching God, the God who approached us, took on the reproach of our sin to give us new life. Ushers, if you can pass out the elements of communion, we're going to come to a meal with the Lord, because there is nothing more approachable than a meal. In those days, in biblical times, in this culture, of the culture that we're reading about, it was not common just to invite anybody over for dinner. Because to share table fellowship with someone, that's what it was called. Like, you invite a person or a family or people to share your table in your house, table fellowship. What you were saying is mi casa su casa, my house is your house. You are able to eat from my table and share my resources. You have rights to ask for what you need from me. You can, anything in my house, if you have need of it, you can. You can use my name and my influence, and like, we're one in that sense. And that's exactly what Jesus is saying for us today and what he did with his disciples. He sat down. God himself sat down at a table and said, come, sit with me, have table fellowship with me. Everything that I am, you can have. All of me for you. My name for you. My resources for you. My provision for you. My nourishment for you. My goodness for you. My reputation for you. My power for you. My healing for you. All that I am for you. Sit. There is nothing more approachable than a meal. So maybe today we can ask ourselves, will we be God's approachable people here on the Central Coast? Will we, as Pastor Brandon encourages us regularly, will we be the ones to bless others? B-L-E-S-S, that acronym, begin in prayer. Begin in prayer for your neighbors and your friends, your coworkers, your classmates. Begin in prayer for them. God, who do you have for me this week? Who do you have for me today? Whether it's at a lunchtime quad or an afternoon coffee or inviting them over dinner, do we begin in prayer? Do we listen first? Do we eat together? Do we serve one another? All for the purpose of sharing the good news and the generous, hospitable love of our Savior with one another. And as the elements are getting passed out, I'd like us to consider three obstacles that often get in the way of holy approachability, or this trait, this attribute that we can see in Christ. Three things I think often get in the way of that, at least in my my life, maybe in our life. One is religion. And again, I'm not talking about undefiled religion of caring for widows and orphans. I'm talking about the religious spirit. Do we tend to substitute conformity to our preferred styles of worship, politics, or non-essential doctrines for true holiness? Because when we do that, we create us and them. We're always the us, they're always the them. Religion or religious spirits always separate people into those categories. And that's what got the Pharisees in a lot of trouble. Do we have any influence of that religious spirit in our life? Number two is hurry. Are we fully present with the people God has in front of us today? I am often guilty of hurry. I am on my way to something else. I'm on my way to someone else. And sometimes I miss the person that God already sent. One of the most important and valuable fruits of holy approachability is to be able to receive the person who's right in front of you. And you all could think of somebody who has that unique or special gift of giving you the gift of being fully seen, known, and not in a hurry to get around you or away from you or past you, but just allows you to be you and you are really seen. That's what Jesus did with the kids, with the Gentiles, with the Samaritans, with his disciples, with everyone. And that's that his spirit in us wants to do that for those around us. And number three is ego. Are we easily offended? Are we quick to anger? Are we easily frustrated? Are we easily consumed with petty disputes or disagreements? Do we find ourselves constantly replaying or rehearsing or just involved in things that are not going to bring the gospel to anyone? Those obstacles of religious spirit, hurry, and ego. There's probably others, but those are the top three, at least for me. So as we consider these elements, the bread and the cup, maybe we could lay our obstacles down at the feet of our Savior and allow His Spirit to make us approachable like Him. I'll come back up in a minute to close. On the night that our Lord gave himself up for us, he looked around a table at his friends. And in that picture, we're all seated at his table with him. And he broke a loaf of bread and he passed it around. And he said, "Take and eat, all of you, for this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then he took a cup. It might have been an ordinary pottery cup of some kind, but it symbolized no ordinary cup. This cup that he had, that he held in his hand, was the cup of God's wrath. You might think, God's wrath? We're talking about love and approachability here. You cannot have love without wrath. If you truly love someone, then you will have that much anger at the things that threaten the one you love. And the cup of God's wrath is full against sin, against Satan, and the works of darkness that have threatened his beloved, that have distracted, deceived, and moved us towards impending destruction and total separation from him. So yes, that wrath is real. There's a lot in that cup. And Jesus, even in the garden of Gethsemane, when he was praying before he was about to be turned over, he said, Father, if there is any other way, let this cup pass from me. He is talking about the wrath of God against sin. But there was no other way. There was no other way. And so Jesus drained the cup of God's wrath every drop. And he experienced God's sentence on sin. And that cup, he passed around to his friends, not for them to partake in God's wrath with him, but he passed around that cup and saying, this is my blood, the cup of my blood that has been shed for you and for the remission of sin, essentially to satisfy and to completely drain the wrath of God on your behalf. So there will never, ever be another drop of wrath towards you again. That, friends, if you don't get happy over that, you ain't happy. So let's do that in remembrance of him. And now if you can stand with us, we want to sing in response to the word that we've received and the meal we've shared, that Christ and Christ alone would be magnified in us.
Where creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry, then from north to south and east to west we hear Christ be magnified. Where the whole earth echoing is eminence, his name would burst from sea and sky, from rivers to the mountain tops, we hear Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ when every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry. Oh, then in one enraptured hymn, with praise we'll sing Christ. You're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. If it brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. 'Cause death is just the doorway into resurrection life. And I'll join you in your sufferings. And I'll join you when you rise. And when you turn in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing, and my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praises arise. Christ be magnified.
Lord of our hearts. He's magnified in our hearts and in our minds. May we go forth this week knowing that God is approachable. He's approachable. And we can come to him and we can make disciples of all peoples, right? That's our job. That's what God's called us to. And so let this moment, this morning, as it's touched your heart, go forth this week proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. Amen. You're dismissed.
Sometimes you gotta stare down the giant, worship from the lion's den. Sometimes you gotta shout it from the mountain, louder in the valley, trusting that he's gonna get you there. Sometimes you gotta welcome the wonder, wait for the answer, worship with your hands in the air. I'll praise you anywhere.